Hello and welcome to the live discussion program, that is our weekly live discussion program in collaboration with National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration. Like every Friday, we come up with different topics on school leadership. Today we have come up with a different topic on teachers' professional development, that is teachers' continuous professional development. And to discuss this topic, we have with us Dr. Subitha G.V. and she is working as assistant professor in National Center for School Leadership, NIPA. So welcome you, ma'am. Ma'am, just introduce this topic with understanding this teacher's professional development, continuous professional development, and its importance.
Sure, Alka. See, what in our country, in the Indian education system, we have schools that are situated in diverse contexts. From what I have learnt from my center is that there are schools located in hilly areas, in geographically difficult contextual areas like the flood prone areas, the urban slums, rural slums, and the kind of children who come from these contexts have different learning needs when they come to the school. Also, teachers in schools have to deal with various other issues like poverty and gender bias and dropouts and even child marriages. So when teachers have to deal with so many issues in the classroom, they need a lot of support and a lot of help, hand holding, to enable them to meet the learning needs of these children who come from such difficult situations and different diverse contexts. So this is where teacher professional development comes in, teachers continuous professional development comes in. And there are innumerable research which says that teacher professional development is very important to bring about teacher change, which has a impact on the attitude and belief system of the teachers, and which in turn impacts their practice, what they do in the classroom, and which impacts the student learning. So it is a very interrelated, interconnected kind of influence that happens. And so I would like to introduce this topic of teacher continuous professional development and its importance for teachers to improve school's quality.
So there must be some national policies on this particular topic, teachers' professional development. Could you please elaborate some of the policies at national level?
On teachers' continuous professional development, yes, definitely there are a number of policies on our policy documents articulated a lot of views about how teachers' continuous professional development should be, and I would like to show a number of articulations of the policy. The National Policy on Education, for example, has recommended a contextually relevant teaching learning process and has emphasized that teachers should have the freedom to innovate, to devise appropriate methods of communication and activities relevant to the needs and capabilities of the and the concerns of the society. Right. So what they're trying to imply, first thing is that teaching should be contextually relevant. Mm-hmm. So a teacher should address the contextual challenges that the child is facing in the classroom. And the teacher's continuous professional development should be in a way that it is socially relevant to the teacher. And the second thing that is emphasized here is the freedom to innovate. So this talks about the teacher agency, to what extent a teacher should have the freedom to manipulate his or her teaching learning process in the classroom depending upon the circumstances in which the child is. And activities relevant to the needs and capabilities and concerns of the society. So the other aspect that is reflected here is how professional development should be related to the society's concerns. Like as we all know that a school is embedded in a bigger, it's a microcosm within a bigger context. So it includes the immediate society and it also includes the international society. So as you know that there are a lot of changes happening, like modern things and technology and new ideas, educational discourses, new ideas are coming up. So the school cannot be isolated from all these, and it needs to, the teachers, in order to prepare the learners of the 21st century, needs to develop those skills and attitudes and beliefs themselves, mm-hmm. so that they can teach the children to become responsible citizens of the country. So this is what the National Policy on Education is trying to emphasize.
There must be some other policies like NCF on teacher education. So could you please explain?
Yeah. You're very right. I would like to say about the Kothari Commission. I'll come to NCFT in the next slide. The Kothari Commission has said that they recognize the importance of teachers in improving the quality of education, and suggested that high quality recruits should be secured for teaching jobs, and that they should be provided the best possible professional preparation. So they need to be given top level help or support in this.
So there are other policies also, like National Curriculum Framework 2005, and then National Curriculum Framework on Teacher Education also. So ma'am, please explain on those policies as well.
So the NCFTE, as you were talking about, the NCFTE has acknowledged that schools need to respond to the broader social, economic and political changes taking place, which I already discussed with you. And it also outlined areas of professional development for the teachers, the all-round development of the child, conformity with constitutional values, activity-based learning, teaching in the mother tongue of the child, making the child free from fear and trauma, and comprehensive and continuous evaluation of the child. These are the specific areas which NCFTE has tried to list down, and these are the areas which in which the teachers need help or support. This all-round development of the child, I would like to give one instance when I compare it with what the various educational discourses that has happened. Like right now, more than children learning individualized learning, there is more emphasis on social learning. So how a teacher needs to move away, shift away from child reading a book by himself to a child sitting in a peer group with a group of three or four children, trying to discuss, trying to make sense of what the subject is, trying to articulate and then come to a conclusion, debate, you know, these kind of skills which if the teachers need to develop. As I already said, these are the latest skills that children need in the work environment. So these are the areas of professional development for teachers, for the all-round development of the child. And NCFT also envisioned that teachers need to be creators of knowledge and ought to be thinking professionals. So what I mean to say by this is, when I say thinking professionals, it is that teachers, we believe that teachers can think for themselves rather than being told what they should do. And thinking comes as teachers as reflective practitioners, when they think that in a classroom, okay, this is a situation, now what should I do? And if I do this, what do you think will be the outcome? And how is that outcome impacting the children in the class? You know, these kind of questions, when you constantly ask, you start thinking about your practice, and you think whether this current practice is okay, or I need to exchange this for another better practice. So you need to be thinking professionals, and that is what NCFT is talking about. And NCFT and NCF have positioned teachers as active facilitators of children's learning, which we have been following in our now in our training programs also to a large extent, as reflective learners who critically engage with the curriculum, syllabus and textbook while following learner-centered pedagogy in the classroom. So these are the various policy articulations which our national policies have set about teacher professional development, and two areas they focused is teachers as reflective practitioners and how CPD should cater to the contextual needs of the teacher, otherwise the professional development does not translate to the classroom situation.
Okay. After understanding these national policies, the question comes in mind that what can be the status of teachers' continuous professional development in our country? So, in the context of these national policies and the real situation, can you explain the status of teachers' continuous professional development in India?
Exactly. So, I'll cut your question, what is the status of CPD in India? CPD has been related or correlated with in-service teacher professional programs, and you know that teachers constantly have this in-service teacher training programs. And one major focus or one major characteristic of CPD in India is the cascade model. And cascade model has this implicit deficiency that it doesn't cater, it doesn't address the attitudes and beliefs of the teacher who's functioning in the classroom, and neither does it cater to the context in which the teacher is teaching. For example, like we through the training models, we give them modules. Maybe it is on RTE or it is on CCE or it is on child-centered pedagogy. So this, when they learn something, policy mandates, when they learn this, the teachers go through the training. But when they come to the classroom, the situation is rather different.
Right.
We need to remember that the context has its own issues. Some may be small schools, and some may lack teachers, some may lack resources, and some may lack the basic compound walls or a structure, a building by themselves, labs, etc. So these are not there in the context. Then how do we translate these kind of like child-centered pedagogy in such situations? So modules externally imposed on teachers does not function for the teachers, because it leads to a big gap in
real situation.
Yeah, in implementation, in real, the transfer of learning doesn't happen. And another aspect is the personal aspect of the teacher. Like it might happen that a teacher is doing a lot of work, but he or she doesn't receive any incentives for doing different work, different from the others.
Right.
Or it may happen that as a teacher, I have gone into the profession by force, because my family situation had me pushed into this profession, and it was not something that I wanted to do. That. So that impacts my belief, my attitude. So external modules through cascade models does not address these very personal characteristics of the teacher, neither does it address the context, and so it just lacks application. So we need to change from looking at teachers as somebody who needs to be trained, from passive teachers to active facilitators of their own professional development, who will lead their own professional development. And we need to move from looking at teacher change as something that is very linear, you give an input and then you get an output kind of a thing, to more of interconnected kind of model of teacher change. So this, in the next few minutes, I will discuss more on this change in perspective. So this is what addressing your question.
You have just explained about some of the challenges of this, particularly this teacher continuous professional development.
Right.
So are there any other challenges, like social context or teaching agent?
Right, policy, policy borrowing, etc. Yeah. No? Yeah, there are a number of more challenges. Maybe there are many more, but I would like to focus on a certain few. The cascade model, I have already told you about its deficiencies. And I would like to focus on this, what you said, policy borrowing. So, policy borrowing as a characteristic, it is by definition, it is when a country, in order to borrows a policy that is working well in another country, mostly a developed country, and you apply it in one's own country, thinking that this will do well in our country. So, this is a aspect of policy borrowing which might not be be helpful. Why I am saying this is, for example, the concept of constructivism. So, this this can be an example of a policy borrowed from developed countries, because it has worked well in developed countries. But constructivism in, for example, in country like India, when we see the cultural and the social aspects of the country and the educational culture of the country does not allow constructivism to be successful. So why I'm saying this is constructivistic knowledge requires children to have a lot of freedom in the classroom, which children can move around, they can discuss, they can interact. But in our kind of a colonized kind of British kind of an education system, we feel too much of freedom can lead to lack of discipline in the classroom. That is one. And here children asking questions to teachers is a sign of arrogance, or it is indiscipline, right? So, and even there is a gender issues in this, where girls have to behave in a certain way, and children from the marginalized communities have to behave in a certain way. So, with all these constraints that are culturally embedded in the culture of the school and the society, constructivism as a phenomena may not apply well in our country. Also, we have schools that doesn't have the resources, that doesn't have teachers, and there is one very important, the lack of agency of teachers, which is there in our country. So, all these things does not, they are constraining factors to applying a policy or a phenomena like this. So, why I'm saying this is constructivism is encouraged in most of our policy documents and most of our training programs. So, such things, it's difficult to apply in classrooms. So, the professional development programs thereby fails. So, policy borrowing is something that can be done with when we design a teacher professional development for teachers.
Maybe constructivism can be adapted within our system by evaluating our system and then understanding the things.
Yeah, well, yeah, definitely, definitely. The context needs to be taken into consideration and try to work on the context, and how the teachers can, within the context, try to bring in this kind of a strategy.
So, how can we bring this changed perspective in teachers' professional development?
So, Alka, there are two more points that I would like to say before I move on to the question to what you asked. One is a teacher agency, and the other is the social context. So, I already mentioned about the teacher agency when I said that teachers are in a hierarchical educational administration. Teachers don't have much freedom to decide what they should do in the classroom. So, what is felt is that teachers, a kind of deficit model is encouraged here, where we believe that teachers lack certain skills or lack certain expertise in teaching, and we need to provide them as an external expert with these skills. So, a deficit model is something that runs in the cascade model and in teachers professional through in-service programs. So, there is a difference between teacher changes and I change the teacher. Mm-hmm. So, which among these is better? What do you think, Alka?
Teacher changes?
Yeah, teacher changes is better because we want teacher leaders, mm-hmm. right? We want teacher leaders who can lead their own learning in their schools, and they have a very good clarity on what are my professional development needs and how do I get them and what is my ladder to success and how are these things related to the school goals. You know, these kind of reflective practitioner, when I say a thinking professional, when I say that has a lot of impact on the word teacher agency. So, I lead my own growth. Mm. So, this is something that we need to imbibe among the teachers. Mm. And designing CPDs need to take into consideration the teacher agency. The other is the social context, right, which I would like to explain. Mm. Social context, I already told you, children come from diverse backgrounds, right? And teaching is a culturally constructed activity, and for teaching to be more empowering, it needs to be culturally authentic. This was a researcher who said this, because teaching cannot be removed from the context, and it is a very cultural thing. And professional development programs need to consider school as situated within a social context, and the complex social world of the teacher needs to be taken into consideration while developing professional development programs.
My question is again that,
yeah,
it, how should we bring this changed perspective in teachers' professional development?
Right. So, it is more of a philosophical question that you are asking me. What I would want to emphasize here is this kind of technical rational approach, it mm-hmm. is called instrumental technical rational approach, it is called, where we think that whatever input we give into a system, there is a change, there is an output, and all the intervening factors like the context, the beliefs, etc., is not important or significant. So, this is a instrumental or technical rational approach. So, what happens here is, you know that teachers are individuals, which we already mm-hmm. discussed. They have their own aspirations, they have their own issues and challenges and home backgrounds and motivation and needs. Mm-hmm. So, the emotional part of the teacher is not taken into consideration in this kind of instrumental approach, which the cascade model, as I already said, follows. Mm-hmm. What we believe is that we give the teachers training on a module and we expect change in right. the classroom, which doesn't happen. Mm-hmm. So, what is the changed perspective that you are asking me is to take into consideration the emotional aspect, the feeling aspects of the teacher, so that we consider teaching not as a product mm-hmm. Process as a input product kind of a thing, but as something which says that
as a process,
yeah, it is a process, yeah, which takes into consideration the emotional aspect. So, one suggestion is that in all professional development programs, there needs to be an assessment criteria which tries to understand wherein under what circumstances did this person behave in mm-hmm. such a way, and what was his attitude and what was his action which led to a certain circumstance, what was he thinking. Mm-hmm. So that once you realize that this is a circumstance and this is a context and this is the way he or she has acted mm-hmm. in this situation, then accordingly your interventions also can happen. Mm-hmm. So, without this, a very generalized module doesn't help a teacher in reaching this kind of expertise.
Yeah. So, there must be some models for teachers professional development. So, can you explain one or two models for the viewers to understand how this professional development of teachers conduct or
can be conducted, yeah. No? Yeah. So, there are six perspectives on teacher change, okay. That is what research says, and change as training, change as adaptation, change as personal development, change as local reform, and change as growth or learning. So, these are various change perspectives on teacher change, which I have told you change is not training, change mm-hmm. is not adaptation, but change as growth or learning is something that we look forward to because it is more ingrained within the teacher and the teacher leads the change. So, I already told you the deficit approach with which we go about, and one important aspect of teacher professional development is the agency of the teacher, which I already said. So, there is a need for a shift in not trying to create the personal inadequacy of the teacher, not trying to look into cater to the personal inadequacy of the teacher, but at a higher level of growth where the teacher feels a greater fulfillment as a practitioner of the art. So, it is at that level of change that we are looking at. Mm-hmm. And talking about the model, yes, that you were asking, the interconnected model of professional development. So, this takes into consideration the personal domain, the domain of practice, the domain of consequence, and the external domain. So, here the personal domain talks about the teacher knowledge, beliefs, and attitude. The domain of practice is the action of the teacher, and the domain of consequence talks about the outcome of the action. And the external domain is the external context of the teacher, which may be constraining or it may be congenial or it may constrain, so whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And the whole interconnection is like let us say I start a new method of teaching in the classroom, mm-hmm. and I have a certain attitude and belief to start that particular method of teaching. I see the practice, I see what do I do in that regard, what is the practice and what is the outcome. So, if there is a positive outcome, then it impacts my belief, right, and the attitude, mm-hmm. which in turn impacts my practice. So, it is a very iterative mm-hmm. kind of a thing, and there is an external domain which is always there and which can be it can create this this influence, mm-hmm. which can influence the reflection and the action mm-hmm. the teacher
positively
performs
or negatively,
in this particular mm-hmm. context. So, this is a interconnected, there may be many more models, but I have just picked this one, mm-hmm. the interconnected model of professional development. So, I would just like to show you the slide. So, we have the external domain, the domain of practice, salient outcomes, and the personal domain, and how it is interconnected.
Okay, fine. So, just briefly, could you tell that how school heads have influence, yeah. or the role of the school heads in improving this teacher's professional development?
Yeah. So, it's a very important question, and to sum up, as a summary, it's a very important question because school heads have a lot of role in improving the teacher's continuous professional development. And in number of my previous mm-hmm. sessions, I have discussed how observation and feedback mm-hmm. helps teachers, how school heads can be coach and mentors, and how school heads can bring about a learning circle within the schools where teachers observe other teachers and give feedback, and they prepare lesson plans together, and they implement the lesson plans, come back, mm-hmm. sit, and then again reflect on their teaching, on their success stories, and on their challenges that they face. So, there is a kind of learning that happens within the schools, and school heads are the ideal site leaders. Right. Who can contribute mm-hmm. to teachers' continuous professional development, because who else will know the context better and who else will know the teacher better other right. than the school heads. Mm-hmm. So, school heads have a very major role in improving the teachers' continuous professional development.
So, So we have well understood about this teacher's continuous professional development, the concept, the models, the status in our country, the challenges, and how we can improve our this program of our teachers' professional development. Thank you so much, ma'am,
thank
for
you,
coming
Monica.
In
thank
our
you.
Studio
thank
and
you.
Giving this beautiful and interesting discussion.
Thank you.
Viewers, you may ask your questions or queries, or you can give us feedback on our toll-free number, or you can send us mail. And also you can give your questions or queries through selfie or video selfie on our WhatsApp number. Our WhatsApp number is 8076754468076 8076754468. तो आपके क्वेश्चंस का इंतजार रहेगा. मंडे को हम जिस टॉपिक करेंगे वो है वुमेन ऑफ नॉर्थ ईस्ट इंडिया मेकिंग अ डिफरेंस. सो कीप वॉचिंग किशोर मंच. थैंक यू सो मच.